Hi, hello everyone. So we're trying to cook some pasta today, some carbonara pasta. And so the list of ingredients is extremely short, and I'm going to show it to you also on some more weights, also written, so that I'm going to show you the ingredients as well in a moment. So the ingredients are just few, so probably we cannot use that. I'm sorry, there is something that is not working with my setup. But the ingredients are, the ingredients list is really short. It's just three things. And it's just, we have cheese. This is pecorino cheese because it's very white, but you can also use parmesan that tends to be a little bit more yellow. We have eggs that are the key part of carbonara. And the other key ingredients is bacon. And so we have, usually in Rome, we use pancetta, guanciale, that is this one here, that is a pork jowl. So it tends to have like a round shape. But it's kind of really fatty as well. So you can see here in this slide. But we can also use bacon if you don't have anything else. This is pancetta or bacon. In this case, you may want to use a little bit of oil, but otherwise we don't use any oil. If you use guanciale, that is really, really fatty. And then of course we need some salt for the pasta. And some black pepper as well. And we can use almost any kind of pasta. We're going to use, you could use easily like spaghetti or macaroni. Those are kind of round and they have some ridges here. And so they're nice because pancetta can fit inside. And we want to use this kind of pasta because it's going to be creamy, our sauce, but it's going to be still a little bit liquid. So we want to have like a pasta shape that can hold our sauce. We don't want to use, and I have to draw a big no here with pasta. That's a no. So we don't want to use penne that are kind of too thin to get the sauce. A type of pasta that can be very, very small, like orzo or pasta that maybe is good for soup, but it's not good for carbonara. And we don't want to use orecchiette or any other shape of pasta that is smooth, because otherwise it won't catch any sauce. So those are no. Just don't use this kind of pasta at all. So we get started by boiling some water. I have a big pot of water here that is boiling. And sorry, there's a computer here. I'm moving around the kitchen. So we have this big pot of water that is boiling. And once it starts, we can add some salt to it. But before we get started, we want to prepare our kind of bacon and our things that they will get cooking as we start. So for the bacon, so I already have like a slice of my guanciale. I already cut some of the guanciale here, and if you see here, I cut it into kind of thin, long shapes so that again, they can go with the pasta very easily. So I'm going to cut this shape with you. If you're cooking with me, like, we can cut this shape. And usually the proportion is one slice of bacon per person, one medium-sized egg per person. If you're using a large size, then I'd recommend using just the yolk. Otherwise, you can use just one full egg, if it is medium or small. around 80 grams of pasta. We're going to weigh it too. So 80 grams is like, let's say, 3 ounces of pasta. You can go easily to 100 grams, like depending on how hungry you are. Usually this is the proportion. And 1 spoon of either pecorino or parmesan or both, depending on your taste. The difference is that Romano cheese, pecorino, Romano comes from sheep milk, and therefore it's really tasty and salty and pungent, while Parmesan comes from cow's milk, and so it's kind of smoother. So it's up to you, depending on how tasty you like your pasta, whether you want to use just one, the other, or both, or a mixture of both. And so this proportion is just for one person. If you're two or more, then you just multiply it. So that's the easy, how easy this is. So again, if you're two people, you will get 2 slices of this, 2 eggs, 200 grams of pasta, 2 spoons of cheese, of grated cheese. So we can cut together these slices of ham that I have here. So again, I'm going to cut it into these sort of thin slices, trying not to cut my finger. And this knife is not working. Not doing its job, so let me change my knife very quickly. Let's get a smaller but more mighty knife. And as we cut it, you can see how this is really, I don't know why the knife are not working tonight. It was working right before. But as you cut it, you will see that how oily this is. It's leaving a lot of oil. And the fat and this oil is what we're going to need to put the pasta. So if we use, if we're using this guanciale that is really, really fatty, it's a little bit like lard, then we don't need to use oil because we're just going to keep in the oil released by the guanciale. Otherwise, if we're using, again, the bacon or pancetta that doesn't have a lot of fat, then you might need to add a little bit of oil to the pan. I want to, before we get started with the actual cooking, I want just to give you a little bit of the scientific theory behind carbonara, how to make a creamy carbonara. I had a slide for it, but I'll share this thing with you at a later stage. So eggs are special in which they coagulate at a specific temperature. They coagulate at 65 degrees or 150 Fahrenheit. So 65 Celsius or 150 Fahrenheit. And when they are at that temperature, then they become creamy and sort of this, basically they cook, but they don't overcook. If you bring them to higher temperature, then you make scrambled eggs or hard boiled eggs where the temperature is much, much higher. So our objective is to have the egg just to coagulate so that it's still creamy and liquid, like when you get a sunny side up egg at the shop. So it will be cooked, okay, because it will be above 60 degrees. So it won't be a raw egg. But, so we have a infographic here, and you can see it. So you see this is low temperature and around 65 degrees, it's creamy. But then if we are at higher temperature, basically we get a hard-boiled egg. So our objective is to get this egg to around 60 to 70 degrees. And to do that, how do we do that? Well, we cannot do that with something that is super scientific because we are in a kitchen and not in a lab. There are some people that do scientific carbonaras, which becomes really, really difficult. But today we're going to do something easy. So the idea is that this thing is at room temperature. So it's around 20 degrees Celsius. If we put the pasta that is very, very hot on top of it, and the pasta is around 100 degrees, then the average temperature of the egg will be around 50 to 60 degrees. And that's going to make our egg creamy and our sauce creamy, and that's how the key to carbonara. So the key is to try to reach around 65 degrees Celsius, 150 Fahrenheit. And again, we don't need to do it using a thermometer. We just know doing the average of the temperature that we reach around that temperature when we do. Okay. So let's get started. So the water here is almost on the point of boiling. I'm going to turn it down a little bit. And I'm going to add some salt to it. I don't know if you ever cook pasta, but if you don't, you add salt to it. I already pre-mixed it. My measure is one fist of salt. That's how much enters in my hand. It kind of depends on your pot and how much water you have. Here we don't have a lot of water. It should be fine, but if you have more water, you may want to add more. So, okay. Then we put our bacon here, our guanciale again. So we put it here, and we slowly. And we slowly let it melt, so then all the grease is left. We put it at a kind of a low temperature, and we want to make sure that this thing reaches a temperature where it's all melted and shiny, and it has released all the. While this is going, we can do our pasta. So again, it's around 80 grams per person, 100 grams. A package is usually 500 grams. Tonight we have three, so I'm going to do basically half the packet. Without being too precise. But that's the basic thing, so I'm going to measure it this way. And again, I'm using one of the approved shape of pasta. Two more at the box. And this one has a cooking time. The cooking time is 13 minutes. So we can fix the time here, 13 minutes. It's going to ring when it's done. So that's easy. We have a timer. And that's easy. So here our bacon is going. I wish we could move the smell as well. Smelling good. It's releasing all the fat into the pan. Okay, it's getting crunchy. And again, when it is transparent, then we will turn off the heat, and then we'll cut up. Here we turn our pasta a little bit, we do that real. And then we start with the eggs. So we're going to do the eggs in the container where we're going to put the pasta. So the idea is that we put the eggs here. The eggs are going to be again at room temperature. Then we're going to put the pasta super hot in here at 100 degrees, and then we are mixing them, and so the eggs will reach around 60 degrees, 70 degrees Celsius, and we'll get our creamy sauce. Oops, one egg. So some people advocate, and I should have done it, for breaking your eggs in a smaller plate. So my eggs are small, that's why I'm using all of them. But otherwise you want to use not so much of the white and more of the yolk. So some people advocate for breaking the eggs in a separate dish so that then it doesn't get to, you can remove all the shell. Then we mix it as if we're doing scrambled eggs, but we're trying not to, okay? If we put something, if we make them too hot, then we're going to make scrambled eggs. And carbonara is not about scrambled eggs, it's about you know, creamy, liquid egg. Okay. So this is looking good, still not transparent though, so I'll leave it on a little bit. And actually, I will move it to the back burner so that it's a lower heat. I'll keep doing my head because I left them properly. Again, you could do it with a fork, you don't have a whisk, you can do it with a fork. Okay. So the egg is ready. I have the cheese here. I might change the spoon and get a larger spoon just in case. And the eggs are ready. The bacon is basically ready. It's here, it's crunchy, it's not bad, you can see. So, yeah. Looks good. So if you want to be do things easily, so do you have any question at this point? I don't see the chat, but if Diana and Randy, if you know if there is anybody with a question.
Not yet, but we just let people know if there's any questions, we'll share them.
Yeah, okay. So at this point, the pro tip is to remove the bacon from the pan so that it doesn't get soggy, because we still have like 10 minutes to go. So if we leave it too much in the pan, it's going to get soggy. So we remove some of the bacon and we just leave the oil here or the fat. Not really for a diet, but it's still decent. So there is a vegetarian version, not a vegan one, because the thing is just all in the egg. So there is a vegetarian version. If you do a vegetarian carbonara, you try to use a zucchini, and you do like a warm up the zucchini with oil here, and then you'll do the rest the way I'm doing it now. And in the remaining time, while the pasta is cooking, and I'm preparing, moving all the bacon from here so then it doesn't get too soggy and it remains a little bit crunchy. It's nice to have different textures. There is a little bit of history of carbonara. I had prepared also like an infographic to go with it, and I can't really show it to you, and I don't know if you can see it in this way. So carbonara, I'm from Rome, in Italy, and carbonara tends to be a dish from Rome. And the idea is that there is a basic pasta in Rome that is called cacio e pepe. It's just cheese and pepper. So if you add bacon to it, it becomes something that is called gricia, that means gray, because the pepper will make the pasta look gray. If you add an egg, then you get carbonara. But if you, the basic preparation, if you add a tomato sauce, then you get what is called amatriciana. So it's really easy. And that kind of gives an explanation for the history of carbonara. So carbonara tends to be a dish from Rome. So like everybody, even today, like people that will meet me in Italy, because of my accent from Rome, they would say, ah, you make me think of carbonara. It's really typical from Rome. But the origin of carbonara is very much debated, because it doesn't exist in any cookbook that was written before 1950. Carbonara is, you find it only in cookbooks that are written past 1950. And so there is the big question, where does this dish come from? We have cacio e pepe in the old cookbooks. We have amatriciana in the old cookbooks. We have gricia. We don't have carbonara. So the idea is that carbonara is actually an American import into the American cooking. That's a theory. So the theory is that during Second World War, when the Allies arrived in Rome and saved Rome from the Nazis, then a cook had to cook pasta for the Allies and the American soldiers, and he didn't have much, but he had what was in the American soldiers' ratio. And what they brought was bacon and powdered eggs. And so he thought of creating a new pasta dish that was based on the, you know, the root of the Roman cooking. So based on cacio e pepe, based on gricia, so with bacon, cheese, and pepper. And then to add to it the egg powdered eggs that was given to the American soldiers while they were in Rome. And that's how carbonara was created, apparently. That's again, many people would say that might not be happy about this history, but that's how research into carbonara is leading to this possibility. And the interesting fact is that the first to date for the people that do this kind of research, culinary research, the first restaurant to have carbonara in a menu was a restaurant from Chicago, of an Italian-American restaurant in Chicago, which sort of makes it possible to think that probably then it was really something that was created at the end of World War II with the influence of the American troops that were in Rome. And I thought it was an interesting fact to share with you. So there isn't much else to do really right now at the kitchen. So you could chat with your friends if you're preparing it with somebody else. You still have 5 minutes to go. If you have questions, again, I can answer questions for the pasta.
I have a quick question. This is Amy. You mentioned like the thermodynamics of the egg, which is interesting. Do you have any recommendations for trying to save it if it does seem like it's going one direction or another, like if it seems like it's getting too hot, or is there a way where if you see it coagulating, you can add something, or how do you recommend getting past that?
I think once it's coagulate. I don't think there is any miracle here.
Unfortunately.
It's like magic. Probably, but again, so there is this other big thing that literally adding milk or cream to carbonara is like a big scene. It's a big no. Like the pasta shapes that I had before, just no milk, no. However, of course, if you see that it's going really, really bad, a drop of cold milk might save it by balancing the temperature again.
But you gotta be, don't do too much.
Don't do it too much. On the other hand, if you see that it's too dry, that it's not, so if you see it's too liquid, then you can add a little, you can cheat by adding more cheese to it and kind of let it kind of dry up a little bit the egg mixture. If you see that instead your eggs mixture is not enough because probably you're using only the yolks of the large eggs, then you can add some drops of the water from the pasta that it will be at the end of cooking. It has a lot of starch in it, and so it kind of, it will make a cream out of your egg because of the starch that has been released by the pasta.
Thanks, I like that.
Yeah. And the starch works with everything, right? Even if you're doing another tomato sauce and you feel it's too liquid, you can add some of the starch from, you have to balance it to a little bit, but you can add the water from the pasta that is cooking because that will be full of starch and will make it kind of denser. More minutes to go, other questions before I...
I don't really have a question, but I have to admit I'm kind of nervous about how this egg process is going to go.
I hope well. It's a trick. Every time it's a little bit of a magic, right? We're doing kind of magic anytime, like making a shoe, or, and then with cooking, it's always like this, that you never know what you're getting. Because of course you shall never put the lid on the pasta, but you never know what you're actually getting. Sometimes you do a thing 10,000 times and it doesn't work. So I hope it works this time. The other day I made a kind of whipped cream and it didn't become a whipped cream because, like Amy was saying, it just went the wrong way and I had no way of recovering it. So I hope it's going to go well. Well, it's going to ring soon. We can taste the pasta as well. Like usually that's what we do. Like we want it al dente, we want it crunchy. Okay. So we can drain the pasta. So if you want to add the water at the end, you may want to dip some. I'm not. I like to lead a risky life, so let me do drain it a little bit. Okay. So our pasta at 100 degrees Celsius. The handle probably even more so because I'm burning my hands. Okay. Then we mix it with the bacon. You see it's turning yellow because these eggs are especially yellow. Then we have a little bit of the fat. This doesn't look super healthy, I know. So yes, just do it once in a while. You cannot have it every day. And then a little bit of good mix so that then the egg starts, starts creating like a nice texture. It's kind of cooking a little bit. So it becomes like the egg in a sunny side up. And then we've got some of the cheese. As I was saying, there are some people that just go with pecorino. We are in the family of compromise. So we just go, a little bit of both. This thing won't stay still. We give it another good mix and you see that it's coming together as it should be. And then finally we give it a little bit of pepper. No kids tonight, so we can add more pepper. Of course you don't want to add that much pepper if there are young people around. And this looks pretty much ready to me. See, there is no more egg left. It's all soaked up by the pasta. It's kind of creamy, or at least it's the kind of sauciness that I tend to like. And that at that point, then there might be different schools and different point of view. But it's not entirely coagulated. As you see, it's like a runny egg. I can put it in the plate. Not super good at plating, but I can put it in the plate. If you want to feel super fancy, you can add some, you can keep some of the bacon and add it on the top. How's a crunchy side. This time I'm not that fancy. I need a different spoon to put it in the plate. Date now. So here. There is somebody that is helping me there. He's going to get the first dish because he's been patiently moving the camera around. And while, which one? Okay. So I'm going to add a little bit more granny style this way. Okay. So you see, it's all yellow. And it's done. So if your question when my kitchen test is eating it, he will give us like his opinion. So if you have any question, I will let you know. So I'm here if you have any question for me. That's done. It was easy, right?
That's so easy. Thank you.
Okay. So if you're all set and if no one asks questions, I might eat my my hardly earned dish of carbonara. If you're following around, and there is really not that much to eat at the end of the day. There are just two pots here. That's it. So
awesome. Thank you so much. That was great. I'm going to put Vittoria's email in the chat. So if anyone has any questions later, you guys can email her. We'll also be putting this video on our website in a week or so. So you guys can watch it again if you have some questions when you're making your dish.
Yes.
But thank you guys for joining us. And thank you, Vittoria, for that great tutorial.
Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome. Have a great evening. And think of me when you're eating
chocolate. Thank you so much.
Definitely.
Thank you.
Bye. Bye-bye.